There aren't too many Subaru WRXs that can claim a 7.7 second quarter mile, but still turn corners on the racetrack. Andy Forrest is certainly one of them. Now, Andy made the trip all the way from Scotland to World Time Attack 2 years ago, and unfortunately, before the main event, he suffered a drivetrain failure. He's back for 2017, and he's made some massive changes to the car. Let's start with that drivetrain failure that you suffered back in 2015. You've made some big changes to rectify that. Can you tell us what you've done?
Basically, the standard Subaru transmission doesn't cope too well with near on £1,000 of torque. So we looked at a transmission that would do two things for us. One, sort out our centre of gravity, which on a normal Subaru is pretty bad, but once you put an H6 engine in, it gets even worse. So one, sort out our centre of gravity, and two, take the load that we're anticipating putting through it. And the obvious contender was a Nissan GT-R 35.
So the R35 transmission is quite unique, because unlike most transmissions which sit directly off the back of the engine, the R35 transmission is actually a transaxle that sits at the rear of the car, correct?
That's correct. It sits in the rear but forward biased, so there's no rear hangover. So you're not bolting a whole load of weight right to the back of the car that would give you an oversteering car. Most of the weight sits within 500, 600 millimetres of the centre of gravity of the car.
So with moving the entire weight of the transmission rearward in the car, what's that actually done for the weight distribution?
Well, that in combination with moving the engine back some 600, 700 millimetres, bolting the engine right back onto the bulkhead, has allowed us to get the car almost 50-50. I think we're about 51-49 at the moment.
That's pretty impressive. Now, coupled with that, the R35 transmission, it's been well proven all around the world to be capable of supporting 2,000 plus horsepower in a drag application, so clearly more than capable of handling what you're going to throw at it.
Yes, it will be. We haven't gone as far as a gear set for it yet. We have the clutch baskets, uprated clutch plates, all the usual bells and whistles that you upgrade on these GTR engines. A Shep 3.5. So normally recommend them for around about 1,000 horsepower.
Now, in terms of those transmissions, they're also a dual clutch transmission, which means that they're computer controlled. Essentially, you've got two gear sets, and while you're in first gear, for example, second gear is already engaged, and when you want to shift gear, it simply disengages the clutch for first gear and engages the clutch for second gear, giving very, very fast shifts. But this also requires computer control. So how's that being handled in your car?
We use the original GT-R GR6 transmission, it's called, the original Nissan TCU, transmission control unit, and we interface with it using EcuTek software, which allows us to then also communicate with the ECU via CAN bus system and control our shift points from there, whether you want them automated, whether you want them on the paddle, whether you do or you don't want auto upshifts, where your downshift limits are. So you can program all that in, along with clutch weights, pressures on the clutch plates, how hard you want your shift. The road car, standard GTR road car, shifts almost seamlessly. You don't feel anything. And they do that by pulling the engine torque back, swapping the clutches very gently. We do it a bit more harshly. We're almost mimicking a dog box, but without the dog thump. So we don't cut the power. We just pull, for example, changing from 3 to 4, you're pulling clutch 4 in quite hard before you let go of clutch 3. And you do it a lot faster than the original transmission does. So it's not as smooth, but you don't want smooth on a race car. You want that push forward.
So the interaction here between the Syvecs and the Nissan TCU or TCM is obviously quite important. And there's a communication backwards and forwards. So when you request a shift, the Nissan TCU will send a torque request through to the Syvecs engine control unit to request a lower torque value, and then the Syvecs ECU in turn will cut engine torque to allow the gear change to be completed. And how is the Syvecs actually reducing engine torque?
I can set that in between the GR6 and the Syvecs. I can determine how much torque it drops, and up until about £700 of torque, it doesn't. We just change gear, and the gearbox has to deal with that. Now, you generate a bit of heat in the clutches, but for events like this, it can live with it. We don't need big oil coolers or anything, but if you're doing a circuit race and you're running 20 laps, you're going to have to maybe ease off those shifts. But we just bang it through the gears. We're no power off. So if you look at the G-force trace on this car, each time you change gear, you get a spike upwards of acceleration.
So in terms of shift speed, how does it compare to the speed of a dog box?
It's a difficult one to compare because a dog box, you have to come off the power to release the dogs and let the next dog in, then you've got to come back on the power. And if you're using a fuel cut, for example, it might be 20 milliseconds before the next cylinder's fueled up. So you have to stack all these things together on a dog box. So someone might say the shift time on a dog box is 30 milliseconds. They're looking at the actual movement of the dog. But if they take the complete power off time, so you're ramping out ignition or you're ramping out fuel, letting the transmission unwind the torque so the dogs can disengage, the dog moves, then the power has to be reintroduced, you might be up in a 70, 80 milliseconds shift time. That's quite similar to what this will do, 70 milliseconds from one clutch starting to engage to the other one fully disengaged, but there's no off time. So where you drop power for maybe 70 milliseconds on a dog box, you actually get a little push forward on this one as the next gear comes in. So it's almost immaterial how long it takes to shift, as it's just like if you remember old cars, switching overdrive on. It's effectively what it's doing. It just changes up a gear with no lift.
Okay, now in terms of the four-wheel drive system, you've retained that, and that's added some complexity because now with the H6 engine moved back in the engine bay, you've essentially got an engine right where a front differential really needs to be, and you've got a really unique solution to that. Can you talk us through the chain drive four-wheel drive system?
That's right. We had the engine, the steering rack, and the front differential all wanted to be in one position. The engine won because it was a big heavy lump that we wanted to be sitting back and low. And so where that sat, we couldn't get a differential underneath it. To sit that flat six engine above a differential would screw the center of gravity of the car. So the solution I came up with was to mount the differential behind the engine. So run the shaft forward from the GR6 transmission to the differential immediately behind the engine. Run short shafts out the side, so in line with the chassis rails. Mount sprockets, run chains forward to secondary sprockets that are on the actual drive shafts.
Okay, so those chains then drive forward. You've got your half shafts are mounted to the chassis driven from there, and you've still got a full front differential. It's just mounted rearward in the chassis?
That's correct, yeah. So it's another heavyweight, or relatively heavyweight, mounted fairly far back.
So again, helping your weight distribution as well. Okay, another change that we saw from 2015 when you were here is in 2015 you were running twin turbochargers. Now you've gone to a single turbo, and I can't find a turbocharger in the engine bay, so talk us through that.
Yeah, I sometimes tell people it's normally aspirated and it really screws with their brain, but it's a single turbo now, single twin scroll, mainly for packaging reasons. Didn't have any issue with the twin turbos, worked really well. And if I could have fit twin turbos in here sensibly, I might have kept that option. But the turbo now sits where the passenger feet would normally be. So the manifolds on these cars that come off the bottom of the engine, obviously being a flat engine, with a dry sump system, there's not a long route round a sump to consider. So they come fairly short primary pipes, into the passenger footwell area, bearing in mind the engine is bolted right into the bulkhead. It's 50 millimetres back, which is regulation for this event. So I end up with very short headers going into a twin-scroll turbo.
So again, moving that turbo back and low down in the chassis, another improvement to your weight distribution as well?
Yes, that as well as dropping overall weight, in as much as if I had the turbo, an option was to fit the turbo in front of the engine, quite common on the four-cylinder engines. But that would be mounting more weight up front. I then have to find some route for a 4-inch exhaust system over above the engine back to pass the midway point. If you were to run a screamer pipe through the bonnet or a full exhaust through the bonnet like drag cars do, that would have been an option to consider. But where I've got it now in the passenger footwell, I end up with an exhaust some maybe 700 millimetres long. So there is no exhaust system on the car effectively in terms of weight. So I've saved a lot of weight there as well.
It makes a lot of sense. How about the heat in the driving compartment for you?
As long as I'm on the move, it's fine. Because the split doors on the car have an open section at the rear, and the aerodynamics of the car, the way the vortices set up the side of the car, the swirls tend to rise up the side, and the air comes blasting in as I drive along. I have to actually put my visor down or shut the side window or anything over about 50 miles an hour, and I can barely see where I'm going for the wind in the car. So it's really cool as long as I'm moving. As soon as I stop, the guys, if they're here in the pit lane, stick the extraction fan on, and it just pulls all the hot air out of there.
Okay, you just touched on the aerodynamics, and obviously that's another really big change that you've made to the car. You've gone through and gone with a complete redesign of the aero package with Andrew Brilliant, I understand?
Yeah, that's correct. We met up with Andrew Brilliant here in 2015, and he clearly knew what he was on about, running the top cars and still running the top cars here at the moment. So he was a man to speak to. He talks the same aero language as I do, so he was interested to get involved, keen to get involved with the car. So he done the scanning of the car, run it through his CAD simulation software, aero package software. I was adamant I want big tunnels on the back like under Suzuki had, and he made it work. Normally you don't get tunnels with a transaxle, you just get a little diffuser or a big diffuser. But to get real tunnels, you had to build out towards the wheels. The car was going to be wide track anyway, so we had a lot of width of car to play with. A conventional car that hasn't been widened this far would struggle to get tunnels in. But he managed to do as I was after and work it from there.
Now, one of the problems that I think is often overlooked with cars that run very high aero downforce at speed is it actually normally results in something of a compromise with the suspension design, because at very high speeds with such high downforce loading, it tends to drop the ride height of the car, and essentially the car can end up bottoming, so you get a compromise where conventionally you'd have to run the car very, very high, which will affect the efficiency of the aero package, particularly the under tray, or you end up running the car with very, very high spring rates, or run the car down onto the bump rubbers at high speed to control the ride height. You've come up with a really unconventional solution to that problem. Can you talk us through the third spring system?
Third springs are fairly common on single-seater cars.
I should say maybe in the time tech, yes. And saloon car world.
Yeah, they're rarely seen in saloon cars, because saloon cars very rarely develop enough downforce to warrant that solution. So we made our own system up that will work like that. In this event, we're only allowed four dampers on the car. And I think that regulation was really meant to mean four coilover dampers in the car. But the wording said dampers, didn't say spring, so I added springs.
So this is really a workaround to get around the wording of the World Time Attack rules?
I guess you could call it that, yeah. So as far as we could see, springs were legal, and we set it up with a third spring, which only acts when both wheels come up at once or the car comes down levelly. So it doesn't really affect your corner spring weight, your spring frequency. So you gain on the low speed and still support the car at high speed.
So in real layman's terms, what it allows you to do is still run a relatively normal spring rate to optimise essentially the mechanical grip of the car, but that third spring comes in at high speed where there's an aero loading which is pushing down equally on both sides of the car and supports the car. Is that sort of a reasonable way of describing it?
That's correct. It's exactly what it does. We had an issue earlier today that one of the link bars to the third spring bent, and the car immediately dropped, I think it was like 40 millimetres at the back, down the main straight. So that's how much it was supporting the car at the back, maintaining the car's attitude to the track and keeping the car at the right height for the track.
Now, another unconventional solution that I've spied in there is to do with that front third spring setup. You've got an air cylinder attached to that. And can you just talk us through what that is going to do once you've got it fully developed?
The intention for that, we kind of ran out of time chasing turbo issues before we arrived. That should have been automated. And the plan was that the third spring could be preloaded in proportion to the speed of the car, or proportion to the square of the speed of the car. So the downforce acting on the car would be offset by the pressure in that cylinder, and it should keep the car constant ride height. The aerodynamics work at the highest efficiency at a certain ride height. If you go above that, you lose out a little bit. If you go below it, you lose out big style, because you can shut the air supply off. So it's quite critical to try and maintain that height on as many turns as possible.
So this is something you're obviously going to have the ability to continue developing and working on when you get back to Scotland?
Yeah, that'll be another knob to twiddle in the car, where I can pretty much set the ride height as I go along. If I need more front aero on the car, instead of having to pull it into pit lane and adjust dampers, I can maybe just drop the ride height a little bit or raise the ride height if we've got issues in the other direction. So it should add a bit of ease to setting up the car.
Oh, look, Andy, it's an amazing package. I can't personally believe how much it's changed since we saw it just 2 years ago in 2015. Obviously, you're still working through some development on the car, and I'm not sure if it'll maybe even see its full potential this weekend, but certainly it's got a lot of potential in it, and we wish you all the best for competition tomorrow.
Okay, thanks very much.
That video, make sure you give it a thumbs up, and if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week, and if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson. You'll learn about performance engine building and EFI tuning, and you'll also have the chance to ask questions, which I'll be answering live. Remember, it's 100% free, so follow the link to claim your spot.